Going back to the point. So you we have Shadi. He is Arab, Christian, Palestinian, and I respect, you know, his way and approach. Respectful person. Came and he is pro. He is a pro Palestinian case. And you know, I'm happy to have this discussion with him. Yeah, we came to a discussion about you know, that the concept of Jesus. As far as I understand, he doesn't believe in the Trinity. Yeah, he believes that Jesus is not God. He believed, he said Jesus is Son of God, and he has interpretation of Son of God, saying that being Son of God, like angels, they are sons or children of God, like Adam was Son of God, and so on and so forth. Now, we came to a point to say, I asked him, then if you believe this, that means you have to, that you accept that Jesus is a messenger of God. He's just only a normal human being. But you said that we have to, if we wanted to ask the God, it has to go through Jesus. That's what you said, yes? So you're if you wanted to make supplication to God, it has to go through the, you know, go Jesus, which means you ask Jesus to help and so on and so forth. And then I came to you, and then I will ask you the same thing. We came to conclusion. What do you mean by Jesus to be Son of God? Then we came to the point, this is the last point, because the recording was the last thing. You know, correct me if I mistaken anything. We came to a point, I said to you, Jesus never claimed to be divine or divine nature, which you believe he has some kind of divine nature. I said to you, he never claimed to be divine. He doesn't have any divine nature. Even in the Bible, it's totally against that. We mentioned, sorry about that. And as well, we said to the, until the last day or the day of judgment, I said to you, from since Allah has created Adam until the day of judgment, Allah has sent prophets and messengers. And Jesus was one of them, one of the prophets and messengers of God. And we believe as Muslims in his miraculous birth. And we believe that he's a prophet and messenger of God. He came to convey the message of God to the people. One of the points which we came to conclusion, which is about you said that Jesus was created, purposely created. Yeah, you said you said he is the first creation. Then he was purposely created to die on the cross. Yeah.
Well, what I believe, right, yes, is that because Adam was the perfect man and he sinned against God, God had to send another perfect man to kind of like forgive us for our sins. That's what I actually believe. And I do believe, just one point you said before, through the line of David, it did say the line would come through, his seed would come through the line of David. Okay. And Mary and Joseph, who was born, actually came through the line of David. This is absolutely important. It came through that royal line.
That's,
well,
but the problem is what we are facing here. Now, if you said, if he was purposely created and he said he knew that he was created, he will die on the cross to expiate the sins of the human being. That was his purpose. Yeah. Then I said to you, if he knew that was his purpose, why he will say the day before he was caught, okay, take this cup away from me? Why he will not submit fully to that? Plus, as well, I said to you, on the cross, he was saying a statement. This statement is as clear as this. He said, Elohim, Elohim, lima shabakhtani, meaning, oh God, why have you, oh my God, why have you forsaken me? Then we have this interpretation. I said to you, so which means Jesus believed God has forsaken him. He believed at that moment God has forsaken him. Now, if he was purposely created for this, why he will complain against the very purpose that he was created for? And if he knew that he's going to be resurrected in 3 days, as you said, why will he complain to God to say, why have you forsaken me? When he knew that God would never forsaken him.
Because I believe he was tortured, he was whipped, he was killed, he was...
It shouldn't change his nature. People less than Jesus, with all my respect, from Palestine, they're tortured, they're whipped, and they have done, killed, disowned. All of these things happened to them. And yet they keep their word as it is. You know, they didn't change. Yeah. Why Jesus will change his word until
the last? He said, why have you forsaken me? Because he felt his power that was God-given go from him at that point. And that's why he said he felt forsaken. He felt his power go out of his body. That's why he did it.
But it, again, it doesn't make sense, because the thing is, I told you before, I give you the example. I said to you, if I saw you here standing, saying to someone, "Oh, why have you? Why did you rob me? Why did you take my money? Whatever," and you have a standard in a way, because you were in the beginning of our discussion, you have a standard. You said, "Oh, if I didn't believe your word, that means I consider you as a liar." Meaning, so I have to believe you from the first start when I'm seeing you saying to someone, "Oh, okay, why have you robbed me?" Yeah? Which means I have to believe this according to your standard, in a way, in or way of thinking.
No, but he said it. I believe from my Christian teaching, he said it because he felt the power go from him, and he was on his own, and he felt so close to.
Is Jesus perfect?
At that time, yeah, he was a perfect man. Yes.
Even at that moment, he was perfect.
Yes.
Okay. I'm asking you, does our emotion? Okay. If someone follow his emotion rather than to follow the truth, is that perfect thing to do, to be done? For example, if I judge according to what I feel, is that something which is perfect nature from a human being?
Well, what you yeah, but a perfect human being
will judge according to his feelings.
Seconds from death.
Huh?
Seconds from death.
Even not seconds.
Torture.
Even moment. Even
moments.
What do you call it?
Minor.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
even at the time when the soul is departing, if he is perfect, as you said, he will be perfect until the very last.
He can
judge by his emotion. This is what you're saying. Even for a second.
Well, I mean, you're putting it. You know why? I take my off, Jai. I know where you're coming from. It's a very good argument. I don't agree what you're saying. I believe that he did say that in honesty. I'm on my own. I think he was pleading with God. I'm on my own.
He didn't say I am on my own.
No, but that.
You know, it's simple. He said, "Oh God." By the way, Prophet Muhammad, he said, "Oh Allah," you know, when in the Battle of Badr, when there were very little amount of people, he said, "Oh Allah, if this people they destroy, you will be never worshipped on this earth." That's it. Of all of us, we are killed now. No, you will never be worshipped. We are the last ones. So Allah supported them. So he was clear. He said, "We are on our own." Jesus didn't say this. According to you, not according to us, according to you, Jesus said, "Why have you forsaken me?" You know what to me? I will tell you something. Are you married?
No.
Were you married before?
No.
Do you have children?
No.
Okay. If your son told you, "Why have you forsaken me?" If you have a son and told you,
Why have you left me?
Why have you forsaken me?
I would put it like that. Okay. I accept your argument. I accept what you're saying. I do.
Okay.
But I'm not a perfect.
Do you think?
We're not perfect-minded people.
I have children. I have children. I try my best to take a good care of them. I try my best to be a good father, to be a role model for them. Of course, we are lacking in different things. But, listen, this is the hypothesis that you are, if God is perfect, we'll never forsake no one. And Jesus knew God is perfect. And if Jesus is perfect, a human being, yeah? So if we give this example, and God has the best example, if my son is perfect and I'm perfect, for example, yeah? And I did my best to be good to my son. And my son, he's a perfect person. He will never say to me, "Why have you forsaken me?" Because he knew I will never forsake him because I'm perfect. And the same thing, my son will never say such word to say to me, "Why have you forsaken me?"
Why you don't believe in Jesus?
No. I'm just this one argument to say that shows that the Christianity are lacking in answering this question. That's one of the questions from many. Yeah, that's this one, just only one, and that shows to say, you know, listen, we believe in Jesus, peace be upon him. He is a human being. We believe in his miraculous birth. We have no problem with this. We don't believe he died on the cross, by the way, that's for you to know. We don't believe he died on the cross. We believe God has taken him up and put him in sleep and took him up to him until before the day of judgment. Allah will send him down, and then he will rule believers, all believers in the world, the true believer, the Muslim, the one who submit to God. That's what we believe as Muslims. Now, when you claim, and he never said to the people, "You cannot worship God except through me. You cannot say, supplicate to God except through me." He never claimed this. He always said to the people, "I will go to my father and your father, my God and your God." He was saying this to them. He was saying, I pray to the father.
Said in the Matthew, nobody comes to God apart from through me?
Through me means following, meaning, of course, these are prophets of God. Of course, if that's the case, it has its own interpretation. You cannot be a true believer in God. Yeah? Yeah, okay. No problem. Yeah? If you are... Yeah.
Why?
I don't know. If you are a true believer in God, yeah? If you are a true believer in God, yeah? As we assume. If you're a true believer in God,
yeah?
Then you should know that, you know, that that if you wanted to believe in God, you cannot believe in God without God sending messengers and prophets to you, to us. So, of course, that's what we have. We say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. You cannot be a believer in Islam until you say Muhammad Rasulullah. The second part. La ilaha illallah is not sufficient by itself. La ilaha illallah, yes, there is no God but Allah. That's part, meaning to believe in Allah. If you don't believe in any of the prophets of Allah, you're a disbeliever in Islam. Any of the prophets, since Adam alayhi salam all the way to Muhammad, all of them, we have to believe in them.
Yes.
If anyone disbelieve in Jesus or Moses or Nuh or Ibrahim, if anyone of the Muslims disbelieve in them, he is a disbeliever, he is outside Islam.
Okay, so what do you think when Muslims are burning the Bible and things like that?
We don't burn the Bible. I don't know. For me, you shouldn't even curse, you know, as Muslims, we shouldn't curse even the idols of others. Just to curse them. And to go and to destroy them. And Allah told us in the Quran, do not curse the people of the disbelief, then they will curse Allah out of enmity. They'll take enmity to Allah and they'll start cursing Allah. We shouldn't do that. Not because they don't deserve, I mean, these idols and these things, but because that we don't want Allah to be cursed because of that, because of the ignorance of the people. Yeah? So the same thing, something which is respectful by someone, why we need to burn it? It's not our position. We shouldn't possess it. We don't say, listen, the Bible, which is nowadays, is not the exactly Bible that was revealed on Jesus, peace be upon him. And there is a lot of changes.
No.
No?
Listen. I read a Quran in English the other day.
I'm not talking about the English. Is there a Bible for the Catholic?
There should be one Bible.
Is there a Bible for the Catholic? I'm asking. Is that one? You know, there are chapters, totally chapters, new chapters.
Like what? Yeah. Name me a chapter in the Bible.
Are you still discussing? I will finish in a minute. Listen, there is no one Bible in the world. There is no one Bible. You know, listen, the Protestant Bible different than the Orthodox Bible, different than the Catholic Bible.
Show me the changes and I'll... Well, listen, it's wrong then, because if people are adding things...
Show you the changes.
Listen.
People adding things.
If people are adding things to the Bible, it's a sin against God. It's simple as.
Yeah, there are many things added to the Bible.
That's not, there are many things.
People who believe in the Trinity, where they added this?
No, the Trinity's not in the Bible.
Yeah, I know, but this, they added it. So it's things are added. Which Bible that you follow?
The Bible I follow is the King James Version, the true version.
King James Bible is not the Catholic one.
No, but they follow that as well. No,
the Catholic, they have more. They have more chapters.
The Catholic,
they have more. They have more chapters.
Chapter.
They have eight chapters. Listen, I'm not here. The thing is...
Yeah, no, this brother wants to speak. Is the camera still running?
Yeah, it's still on, yeah.
You want to come in here?
Please.
Yeah, just... So there are add things being added to the Bible, things being taken from the Bible.
Yes, right.
And one of the things, for example, there are revised versions, isn't it? Even for King James, there are revised versions.
Yes, there are revised versions.
So, what means revised?
Because languages, you know.
No, revised, the same language.
It's the, thou, and that, you know.
No, revised version, they add. For example, in before they used to say, you are my only begotten son. They take, in the revised version, they taken out begotten.
No.
What has happened?
No, they've updated the English. Ijaz, excuse me, come here.
Yes,
Ijaz.
Ijaz.
Nice to meet you.
Nice meeting you, and good to have a discussion. Yeah.